Welcome back to the Telethon. I'm Richard Troches. You hope you're donating often and generously, because that's the thing to do for the Telethon. This is all about 14 harm reduction initiatives across the country, and all the money is going 100% to them for all the good work they're doing. It's a great big love letter from all the fine people across Canada. So donate now if you haven't already, and if you have already, consider donating again, because I mean, you know, in the great scheme of things, you know, you're gonna want to say you help someone out. We're talking about love now on the Telethon, something I've been accused of knowing nothing about or being any good at. And you know, they're not wrong. I mean, who's once, twice, thrice, 30, 40 times a loser? Who's to say? I'm a late bloomer. Sometimes you just have to say no, you know. I've taken advantage of people, and I suppose that they're guilty of enabling me, but I've manipulated that situation to take advantage of it, and that's on me, not them. They're just offering love and support, and I've taken advantage of that situation and abused it. And I wish people would have said no, of course, when I took that for an answer. But you got to set them boundaries. That's important. Draw a hard line and fill it with tough love. I love my son. No one believes that, but I do. In my own way, in my strange way, I love you, Joe. I always did. No one can take that from me. I love you, man. I watched you, and I thought about you all the time. I love you, and I love harm reduction. I'm not kidding. I've learned so much here today. I mean, I've been a fool. These people are amazing. I mean, I'm floored with the youth and the people out there these days, what they're doing. We didn't do anything, you know. Like, we sit down, you know, a bunch of hippies, like, sit down and feed us. Like, well, that's not, you know, that's, you're kind of phoning it in there, right? Like, went to Yorkville and like met Neil Young, you know, a couple times. Like, who cares? I love you so much. I think about you all the time. It's the only thing I did good in this world was make you. And I know you don't really want anything to do with me, and I don't blame you. I abandoned you in your life, and I can't ever forgive myself for that. So I can't ask that you do. But if you ever did consider forgiving me, would be the only way that I might be able to forgive myself. But that's probably not going to happen, because we got another many hours of the Telethon, and you got to love before it's too late. You got to love long, and you got to love wide. Love is the answer, and what is gone, you're going to know it. You're going to know it. You're going to be in either a figurative or metaphorical or real ravine, swamp situation. And, your neighbors and friends are going to leave you, and they're going to all be having a ball, and they're going to be, they're going to be stuffing animals and throwing back, female bacon sandwiches and drinking that really expensive Labatt's beer, and your life's just going to pass you by. You're just going to be down there all by yourself, living free in your lonely, pantsless life. Love. No, I don't. You want it. Just cultivate love. I mean, there's dirt in the ditch. It's your last scratch. You better cultivate some love with it.
I had a friend who died of an overdose several years ago, and he was a really, really wonderful guy, the kind of guy who actually, after he died a little while after, I wasn't sure how close we were because I felt so close to him when he died, and we were close, but he was the kind of person that made everyone feel like, you know, they were his best friend. He was a very charismatic person, but he would lie, and not in a destructive way or a way that would harm anyone, but just sort of odd lies. Like he'd say that he had met like George Clooney at Starbucks and then they'd gone horseback riding, or you know, something kind of silly like that wasn't harmful to anyone. He was just a performer, and he'd elaborate. Obviously it was really shocking when he died, and you know, a lot of people have been really close to him. There was two different memorials for him, and both of them were super packed, often with people, you know, who had only met him just recently and loved him. One of the things about him that everyone knew was that he was allergic to potatoes, so you know, he couldn't have any fries. This was always a thing that you were very aware of if you went out for dinner with him. And we went to his hometown, me and some friends went to his hometown for his memorial, which ended up just being this really beautiful celebration of performances. And during the day, his father got on stage and started talking about him and what he'd been like as a child. And he revealed that when he had been young, I guess he tried potatoes and then just decided he didn't like them. So he told everyone he was allergic from that day forward, and the collective gasp that went up in the audience when that moment happened was so funny. It was just like the biggest shock to all of us that our friend had just decided to lie about being allergic to potatoes all his life just because he just didn't like them. And I guess I don't even think it was a more convenient thing. I think it was probably just the more fun thing for him to do. So that's something that I think about quite a bit.
So an addiction is a complex psychological, physiological process, but which manifests in any behavior that a person enjoys, finds relief in, and therefore craves in the short term, but suffers negative consequences in the long term and doesn't give up despite the negative consequences. So craving pleasure, relief in the short term, negative consequences in the long term, inability to give it up. Now, notice I have said nothing about substances. I said any behavior. So it could be related to cocaine, crystal meth, heroin, fentanyl, marijuana, nicotine, alcohol, whatever. Could also be sex, gambling, internet, relationships, shopping, eating, work, extreme sports, working out, pornography, any number of human activities. So I said any behavior. Now, the official definition of addiction, according to the American Society for Addiction Medicine, is that this is a primary brain disorder. It arises in the brain, largely due to genetic reasons. This is how they see it. And I say that's just not true. The other popular idea about addiction is that it's a choice that somebody makes, that people choose to be addicted, which is what the legal system is based on. Because if people are not choosing, what are we punishing them for? And although I think the medical definition is closer to the truth, I don't see it as genetic. It's a genetic disorder, and I don't see it as a primary brain disorder. So let me perhaps show you why, if that's okay. A human being has two fundamental needs, apart from the physical needs, in infancy, in childhood. One is for attachment. Now, attachment is the closeness and proximity with another human being for the sake of being looked after, or for the sake of looking after the other. Now, human beings, as mammals, and even birds, are creatures of attachment. We have to connect and attach, because otherwise we don't survive. If there's nobody that's motivated to take care of us, to attach to us that way, and we're not motivated to attach to others, we just can't survive. One interesting thing is that the endorphins, which are the body's internal opiate chemicals, which heroin and all the other opiates resemble, they help to facilitate attachment. So if you take infant mice and you knock out their endorphin receptors so they don't have endorphin opiate activity in their brain, they won't cry for help and separate from their mothers, which would mean that they would die in the wild. And which goes back to what happens in early in childhood when there's stress and trauma, these endorphin systems don't develop. And then when people do heroin, it feels like a warm, soft hug to them. They feel love and connection for the first time. That's why it's so powerful. But so we have this need for attachment, without which obviously the human infant, who is the most helpless, the most dependent, the least mature of any creature in the universe at birth, cannot survive without the attachment. And that attachment relationship, given that we have the longest period of development of any creature, you know, well into adolescence and beyond, attachment is not a negotiable need. But we have another need, which is authenticity. Now, authenticity, out of the self, means being connected to ourselves. Just knowing what we feel and being able to act on it. So, that means our gut feelings. So, let's look at how human beings evolved. For hundreds of thousands of years, and for 100,000 years or so of this species existing on Earth, how did we live? We didn't live in cities and houses and so on. We lived out there in the wild until very recently in human existence. Now, just how long do you survive in the wild if you're not connected to your gut feelings? Not very long. If you start using your intellect instead of your gut feelings, you just don't survive. So that's a powerful survival need as well. So attachment is a survival need. Authenticity is a survival need. But what happens if your authenticity threatens your attachment relationships? For example, as a two-year-old, you get angry because you didn't get that cookie before dinner. But your parents can't handle anger because they grew up in homes when there was rageaholism and they're terrified at the very expression of anger. So they give you the message that good little kids don't get angry. The message you receive is not that good little kids don't get angry, but that angry little kids don't get loved. Because your parents are now sullen, they won't look at you, they talk to you in a harsh way, you're not getting loved. Not experiencing love at that moment. Now, but you got to stay attached. Guess what you're going to suppress? The authenticity every time. And this is how we lose connection to ourselves and to our gut feelings. So that, strangely enough, that very dynamic, which is essential for human survival in a natural setting, not becomes a threat to our survival in this more modern setting, where to stay authentic is to threaten attachment. And so we give up our authenticity, and then we wonder who the hell we are, and whose life is this, and who's experiencing all this, and this life doesn't... You know, and who am I really? And so that's where the reconnection has to happen. That's where the healing happens, is with that reconnection. But it's because of that conflict, that tragic conflict in childhood between authenticity and attachment that most of us face, that we lose ourselves and lose connection to our gut feelings. Now, this leads to the question of trauma, because it's one thing to recognize that all this originates in childhood pain. It's quite another to transform that pain. And for that, we have to understand what trauma is. So people often think that trauma is what happens to you. So trauma is a divorce when you were small and your parents fighting. Trauma is your mother's depression. Trauma is your father's alcoholism. Trauma is your parents' argumentation. Trauma is physical or sexual abuse or some loss. Those aren't the traumas. Those are traumatic. But the trauma is not what happens to you. The trauma is what happens inside you. And as a result of these traumatic events, what happens inside you is you get disconnected from your emotions and you're disconnected from your body. And you have difficulty being in the present moment. And you develop a negative view of your world and a negative view of yourself and a defensive view of other people. And these perspectives keep showing up in your life in the present. So in other words, the addiction is not the primary problem. It's an attempt to solve a problem. And then the real question is, how did the problem arise? In other words, this is where my theory is that it's always rooted in childhood trauma, mm-hmm. and that the addiction is an attempt to deal with the effects of childhood trauma, which it does temporarily, mm-hmm. while it creates even more problems in the long term. And so the issue is not just to recognize what happened 10, 15, 30, however many years ago, but to actually recognize the manifestations in the present moment and to transcend them. And how do you do that? By reconnecting with yourself, by restoring the connection with your body primarily and with your emotions that you lost. And once you do, when you found these things again, then you have what we call recovery. Because what does it mean to recover something? It means to find it again. So what is it that people find when they recover? They find themselves. And the loss of self is the essence of trauma. So the real purpose of addiction treatment, mental health treatment, any kind of healing, is reconnection.
Said so, how can I believe you now? It's just the way you never tried. Still so hard to say goodbye. Gave so much to you, and you took it all from me. And after all the slack, you never had my back. So take it all now, cause all that's left is a broken husk, and you're welcome to. Rubble girl, I was blinded by the potential of us. All the times you cried on me, all the times you had me believe, all the times I picked up the mess. I just started to love you less. And when you break, and I know you will, you'll stand alone. Oh girl, what a bitter pill. And when you break, so take it all now, cause all that's left is a broken husk, and you're welcome to. Rubble girl, blinded by the potential of us, and when you break, and I know you will, you'll stand alone. Oh girl, what a bitter pill. Oh girl, what a bitter pill. Oh girl, what a bitter pill.
Answer, not to be completely hippie. I know that most people disregard that because it is such a hippie thing to say, but it is honestly the truth. We wouldn't be here without social support. We wouldn't be in these complex societies as we are today without social support. And to think that we can achieve anything without it is ludicrous, just completely ludicrous, because if we think of anything we've achieved, we have not achieved it alone. Nothing in our life we have actually achieved alone. We can always think of one person that has helped us either gain the skill to achieve that, right? Like we're a collective people, so we need each other. And I think our individualism is getting in the way of that, and is actually reversing the evolutionary process right now. Because we wouldn't have all these fantastic, lovely parts in our brains without other people to grow them with. But then we'll kind of talking about self-love and forgiveness as well. I think that's a major part in most people's path. That's kind of why they work together, because we need to end this stigma as a community so people can stop stigmatizing themselves, right? It's hard to love yourself when everyone tells you that you're a degenerate and that you could do better, or, you know, you had so much potential and you threw it all away, right? Those are very static stereotypes, but we're dynamic people. We can evolve through that, right? But you never hear people saying that unless it's us, right? Talking about harm reduction, but the main media, depiction of addiction is that people are stuck in that ways. So I think we need to stop defining other people and letting other people define themselves. That is a form of love. That is allowing people agency to create themselves. But it also helps them realize that, their self-worth, and that self-worth is huge, because that self-worth makes you realize that, oh, I deserve more than toxic relationships. And that I get to choose who I want to be. It allows us to look back, and it allows us to forgive ourselves, because a lot of the times when we're getting over trauma, it's not, you know, reliving or reprocessing that particular event. It's learning to love and forgive the person that you had to become in order to deal with that. And a lot of people have big struggles with that and hating the person they had to become. It's almost like this expectation of people to be superhuman, which they're not. Anyone who's faced with that amount of trauma will break, right? Unless they have social supports, but, you know, a lot of the times they don't have social supports. So just realizing that, you know, not having perfectionist expectations of self, but to realize that, you know, anyone going through the same thing that I went through will end up in the same place, right? Especially if all those factors were in it. No one's really above other people. We all just have different levels of resilience, and that resilience is usually within our community and the people that we are around. So I honestly think it's kind of a two-way street, right? We need to start building community for people who are going through trauma, through addiction. And that way those people can, you know, have a picture of what love is and what unconditional love is, so they can start treating themselves that way. But most of the time, they're not met with that unconditional love. They're met with conditional love. So they hold the same standards to themselves throughout their lives. And that's what's self-destructing in them.
That in you. Put that in you, son. There you go. There you go. You know?
Funky motherfucker will not be. Don't you go, whoa, 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 bridge, whoa, 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 whoa,
I'm sorry, man. My story with my disability is a bit of a complicated one. I have a condition that is genetic, and technically I've had it my whole life, but I didn't know I had it. When I was growing up, I thought I was just clumsy, unlucky. I was called a drama queen a lot from family when I complained of pain and different symptoms. And it wasn't until I was 17 that all of a sudden my symptoms became impossible to ignore. And I went from kind of being able to have what I thought was a normal life to not being able to lift my hands to wash my hair. I had to leave school, which I just got into university. I was so excited to build a life. And in that time, I went to doctors because all of a sudden something really, really big was going on. And they did all the tests that you do at the beginning when someone has big neurological things. And the test came back not showing anything. And for 4.5 years, I was labeled as someone who was seeking drugs, as someone that was, I had a lot of different diagnoses kind of put on me, things like conversion disorder. And I wasn't ever offered help or support for those diagnoses. I was just kind of kicked out of hospitals frequently. I would be brought in by ambulance and then kicked out. And told that I was wasting everyone's time. And meanwhile, my life was completely falling apart. And through that experience, I realized that the symptoms that I had were awful. They were really severe, but they were not as harmful as the treatment I received. The trauma from my experience came from the way that people viewed me and treated me, the fact that no one believed me, and that I felt like I was on fire. And not only did nobody really seem to care about helping me put it out, they kept saying, ah, there's no fire. Why are you wasting our time saying there's a fire? And that was a hugely formative several years for me. And it's not exclusively in the past. I mean, now today I've had a diagnosis. I now have more of a team beside me. I've been able to access supports through that diagnosis, things like a wheelchair and, you know, access to ODSP and funding and occupational therapy, which I didn't have before when I was being kind of just kicked out of spaces. And if I could change anything, it would not be my condition. It wouldn't be my symptoms. I don't care all that much about walking places or running places. I certainly would like to have a little bit more energy throughout the day, but that's not my priority. That wouldn't change things dramatically for me. The only thing I would change is to be offered a bit more space and a little bit more care. And so in my work today, that's the crux of what I try to do. is create spaces, whether I'm putting on a show, which seems pretty low stakes, or whether I'm working with someone in community, to make sure that my interactions with them ideally help in some way. That would be great. I'd love that. But even if I can't, to make sure that I'm leading from a place of care.
Oh, sorry, Eleanor. Didn't mean to interrupt.
Oh, no, you weren't interrupting. I was just thinking about some old friends. Life has a funny way of working.
Who's that?
This is the first man I ever loved. August Cotter. He was a huckster. Swept me off my feet the moment I met him. His smile could cure the Russian flu.
What happened to him?
Well, things were complicated. He had an identical twin brother, James Cotter. Now, James had a goatee, that's how you could tell the difference. The sad truth was James also loved me. And if he couldn't have me, neither could August. One night, James went mad, tried to burn our house down. I knew it wasn't safe, so I ended up running away.
I'm so sorry, Aunt Eleanor.
Took a train east as far as it would go. Before I knew it, I met a miner, Damien Mellotropy.
So was it Damien who you ended up with?
No, not quite. Lovely man, but we were in an open relationship. He was courting Elizabeth and Shirley, and I was seeing Nicholas, Genevieve, Lawrence, and Sylvester. Damien and I were stronger than ever until Nicholas gave the group of us STDs. Horrific sight, if you ask me.
Oh my god, no, don't need to see that. Thank you. No, thank you. I see everything.
Anyway, where was I? He was a little man, 4'9", but boy, could he sing. That was the farthest thing from a book club. All lesbians, all illiterate. Juggler. Jakey Snake Oil. At this point, I think I have 6 kids. I don't know where they went. This guy introduced me to morphine and missionary.
Siamese twins?
Maybe.
She turned out
till
to
he
be
was stomped on by a circus.
I'm not even like bring up
or to leave those carnival corn dogs. Best I ever had. And the Marine, Frederick Williams. The man I had children with was, well, he was flanked in the war.
Will you just play your damn cards already?
I'm taking my time, okay? Wait, do you hear that?
I don't hear nothing.
Shh. Would you...
I really did love Frederick.
If it wasn't Frederick, who was it?
It just so happens that the man they sent to inform me of Frederick's death was Corporal August Cotter.
The huckster.
My whole journey took me right back to the man I first loved. But that didn't last long because his brother James shot him directly in the back. That happened yesterday. James is armed and dangerous. Love is a crazy thing, Isaac.
To say no. That's the subject under discussion. And there are plenty of times in life when you have to say no. Fortunately, sometimes it's easy. Saying no to the time is simple as this.
No.
Thanks for asking me, but no.
Yes, sometimes just plain no is best. But sometimes such a direct no would offend people, cause you to lose your friends. Make you seem to disapprove of them.
And if you just take a subscription for only 1 year, I can get that bicycle.
Well, new suit, new hat, new gloves. Do you like them?
Well, we're through with that guy.
Yeah. Too chicken to pick up some dames with us. You're coming, aren't you, Johnny?
Well, how can you say no and still keep your friends? Now, that's quite a problem sometimes. Well, let's sit in on a discussion of that problem. Come in. Here are some of my friends. I think you'll find they have helpful opinions. I'd like to present Marty and Lucy, Nora, and Howie.
Hi, gang.
Oh, and I'm Bill. Well, we're going to discuss saying no and still keeping your friends. But you'll see better what we mean if we get right to our examples. Marty, I believe you had an incident you wanted us to discuss.
Well,
go ahead.
Well, the fellows and I often stop somewhere for a snack after a game or after practice. It's usually just an ordinary place where you can get a good sandwich. But sometimes the fellows pick a tavern. And then...
Well, service here. Well, how about it?
Let's have a drink.
A drink? Sure, swell idea.
Well, I dare you. What do you mean, dare? A drink never hurt anybody, eh, Marty?
Well,
up here, boy.
I'll have a beer.
Me too.
Beer? Huh. Scotch and soda for us, eh, Marty?
Well, that's the situation. What can I say? Because I want to get along well with those fellows on the team. I don't want them to think I'm a drip.
Well, couldn't you just tell them you're in training?
Well, those fellows are supposed to be in training, too.
Well, that makes it harder.
No wonder we lost so many games.
I'll bet they really feel a little guilty themselves if they're in training. Why couldn't you just order something else?
Maybe. How? What would I say?
Well, just whatever you would say anyway, if you were ordering. Don't you think that he should be direct?
Mm-hmm. Sure. Yeah, I think so. But without making any fuss about it, just order what you want.
Well, let's see. How would that go?
Scotch and soda for us, eh, Marty?
I'll take a double hamburger with french fries.
No drink?
No, I'm hungry. Yeah, I think that might work. You know, I'll try it next time.
I don't think it'll work at all. Not if the boys are at all insistent. Maybe they'll let it go at that, but there are a lot of kids who won't give in so easily. Let me tell you, happens all the time at pajama parties, for example. We get all settled down and the hostess mother's safely out of the way, and then...
Boy, I'm dying for a smoke. How about you girls? Mary?
Well, thanks.
Nora?
No, thanks. I've got some gum somewhere.
Light? Sure you won't, Nora?
No, thanks, really. I'd rather have the gum.
Oh, come on, Nora. Be a good sport.
Yes, try it. Just this once. Here, take a puff on mine.
See what I mean? No just doesn't mean no to some people.
Well, I don't think she's very much of a hostess. If she forces things on you like that...
Well, there's some consolation in that. But seriously, I can't give up a friend just because of one little fault like that. How can I say no and really make it stick?
Why don't you try some parlor tricks? You can always distract attention with a good card trick. Here, take card, come on.
You're the one that's distracting now.
No, wait. Distraction is an answer. Oh, I don't mean card tricks, but you can say no and change the subject. Bring up the latest gossip.
Sure, maybe.
Could be.
You see?
Oh, Howie. Well, let's see how that might work.
Here, take a puff on mine.
No, thanks, Rose.
Oh, go ahead.
Say, have you heard about Ted and Margaret breaking up?
No. Well, who's she out after now?
Yes, what's the story?
Well, I guess that Ted is... That may be a pretty rosy version of what would happen. It might work, though.
See, distraction. Change the subject.
It takes more than changing the subject to... Well, what about the problem of boys?
Their hands, you know.
Lucy, You promised not to tell.
Oh, I didn't mention any names. But seriously, I've run into problems like this a lot. You get home from a date, and it's still early enough to stay outside for a while to talk. Some talk. It's a funny thing. This boy has probably been good company on the date, but just give him half a chance alone, and there's just no stopping him.
Moral, don't spend time alone with him. Simply don't get into a situation like that.
Oh, it isn't quite as simple as that, is it? He has to take you home sometime.
So you ask him in. Your folks are up, and you have something to eat in the kitchen, and then you say goodnight.
That's a help, all right. But really, you can't help getting into situations where petting's likely to start. When you're dating a car, at the movies, even in your own home, watching television.
You know, I never thought of that before.
Well, why don't we take some cases, starting with yours, Lucy, and show just how you can say no.
All right. We'll say that this time I didn't plan ahead. And here we are, on the front steps. Tell me, what are you going out for in the track meet next Saturday?
Oh, the relays, I guess.
Oh, how wonderful.
Or take the case of the girl who finds herself in this situation.
Say, is anybody else hungry? How about it, you two? Couldn't we go someplace for something to eat?
Just a minute. I'm not sure those are very good examples. That poor guy in the front seat of the car sure was mad. And the other guy...
But, Bill, it's not easy, you know. Why, you have to have a whole bag full of tricks to handle situations because... Well, because each one is different.
That's right. And fellas react differently. Seriously.
You? Serious?
You girls seem to think it's always the boy who starts things.
Well, naturally.
Oh, no, Lucy. Well, sometimes we're partly to blame. We invite a little attention. Goes on, and then it's hard to stop.
There are times when it's up to the boy to say no.
Some fellows seem to think that petting's, well, the thing to do.
And some girls think that they have to permit it for date insurance. Well, each of us has to set his own standards, I guess.
Yes, but those standards vary with a lot of things. If you really like a boy, you want to be close. You want to hold hands, maybe a goodnight kiss, and so on. It's the and so ons that are troublesome.
But, well, I think the important thing is to know yourself and your standards. Know when and how you're going to say no, but in advance.
Even then, it takes all the ingenuity you have.
Well, I think we've cleared the air a bit. And we've outlined some skills in saying no and still keeping your friends. I think we ought to list them again and review.
Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm.
Lucy?
Try to avoid difficult situations.
Howie? Distraction. Change the subject.
Nora?
Know exactly when you want to say no and be definite.
Marty?
And then say no. Friendly as possible, but still no.
But don't be too preachy.
Well, I think there are some good ideas here. What do you think?
How about talking this problem over? It's worth some effort to learn how to say no and still keep your friends.
I think I was really lucky because you were sort of in it too, but I think I was lucky that I kind of grew up and came up with a group of folks like workers and peer workers and lived experience workers. And I feel lucky that I would never be audacious enough to say that I was like fully immersed in the community because I had way more privilege and way more access than lots of the kids I worked with. But I think that like there was a whole group, and even in their separate little groups, be it by like drug of choice or music or whatever, the youth link was like the gathering place and the meeting place for all of those kids, and everybody knew. And the other place that I think, you know, gets forgotten about, fucking Sketch. Like, what about Sketch? They did so much rad work. They had such different relationships with the youth there because they had this open, I don't even know, like, probably nothing in Sketch's language says anything about harm reduction. It was just a place for youth to come and do art. And everybody that worked there was total hippie. And it was just like, bang on those drums, play that guitar, build a fucking table, like do whatever you want. It was such a, they were such cool things. And then I just think the pendulum swings so much, right? It's like, I've watched all those systems change. And I think that was the cool part about it, that everybody kind of knew everybody and people truly had each other's back. And so you got to find your tribe and you got to create a community out of it and you got to have each other's back. And you can't, you know, I don't know. I also grew up in a small town, so I totally get, you know, that there would be nights where I'd see like Richard punch chicken wings head right in and the next night they were drinking together, you know? So, I mean, I totally, we all know that group. I feel like that's the group I came up with. You could just have a shit night and punch the shit out of each other. And the next day you're like, woof, sorry about that. You're good. We're good. We're good. So it is community and love for sure.
Community. Sustainability. Heavy binge drinking. We are anonymous alcoholics. Tired of your rampant alcoholism but never want to do anything about it? Why not continue to get drunk and do something for your community? Our drunks are working hard to deliver our communities a brighter, blurrier future. You can too.
And over this graffiti on this historical bridge, I drank a bottle of wine, 15 beers, and I painted over the graffiti on this historical bridge.
I drank a twig syrup of tequila, and I had some beers, and I shit my pants a little bit, and then I painted this mural. It celebrates the diversity of the multiculturalism of this community.
I used to sit around all day getting drunk and contemplating suicide. What are you? Now I do gardening, and the community loves it. And the best thing is, I still get to get drunk and contemplate suicide. It's great.
So remember, the next time you see a drunk guy with a shovel, say, thanks for the new community garden. Then run like hell before the whiskey rage kicks in. Anonymous Alcoholics, making a better future, one drink at a time.
Yo, unknown misery, what's going on, man? Let's get into this right now. Hobo TV live performance. We're about to get into it someday after the Empty Handed Warrior album produced by Anyway. Big up T Dr. France, man.
Yeah. Yeah. Yo. Open your mind. Yeah. Keep that mind open. Yeah. Yo, no spine to walk with, no mind to process, no heart or conscience, hypnotized and locked in. Shoot at the sky and profits, hoping some changes drop it. Keeping it paved to cement while it's still wet. Leave a print of your soul, not on your soul. Environment closed will expose the space you need to grow. Think before the action, control the reaction. You could infect or heal with your own passion. Feel the elements and surf on the devilish. I do and did what the God and the devil did. Into minds, the reflection of truth speaking, tweak rebellious. When some but learn from over what you lose, you penniless. Still handle change well. For everyone I burn, I earn a lesson for a brain cell. My love is so deep, I paint hell with love. My love is so deep, I paint hell with blood. Someday, the rain will drop like rain. One day, they'll feel this pain I painted. Someday, we'll have a reason to tear. One day, things will come, the frequencies will be clear. Someday, we will be unchained in the spirit, in the flesh, and in the brain. Someday, we'll see it, there will be no pain. Day after day, we count until someday. Life's a paper chase, but only on the surface. Learn the art of war and how to slither with the serpents. We need to fight the power, need the paper, love the hustle. Hustle for the paper, need the paper for a purpose. The vapors from the ganja got me calm and collected. Reflected some of my history, unknown like my misery. Selected by my melanin, the slave in the hot sun. Crave shiny things, hot guns till we pop some. Locked in the hot slum, victims when the cops come. Plantation thinking, my people are sinking. BYTA. We don't play as praxis. Black magic, lying strength, taking action. Hunting from a rooftop, calling eyes and two shots. They study the TV, fuck the police. Roll with my codeine, not a cuff can hold me. Someday, 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 we'll be free. Someday, 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 we will see. Someday, 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 we'll be free. Someday, we'll be free. Peace, Hobo TV.
One of the things I like to talk about when folks say, well, I'm spiritual, but I'm not religious. I don't know if I believe in God. I don't know if I believe in God because you can't prove to me that there is a God. And I often will say, you know, you're absolutely right. I can't prove it. But do you love your mother? Or do you love your husband? Or do you love your children? And they'll say, of course I do. And I'll say, prove it. Prove it. Because you can't prove that to me. You can show me some of the things that you do because you love them. Well, I could show you some of the things I do because of God. So it's the same thing. For me, God is where love is. And where love is, there is God. That's my definition of God. I don't believe in some old fella sitting in a cloud, you know, playing us around like chess pieces and making things happen to us and all. I don't believe in that. I believe that wherever love is, there also is God. And one of the parts about love for me is about self-love. And that has, you've got to love yourself before you can love someone else. And that oftentimes will mean giving yourself a break and giving yourself the opportunity to say, yes, I have made mistakes in my life. I've made some terrible mistakes in my life. But what have I learned from them? And if I've learned from them, I can let it go. I can forgive myself. Forgive myself for my mistakes. Forgive myself for how I've hurt people. I might need to go and apologize, and I might need to offer some explanation. But holding on to anger and not forgiving is like taking poison and expecting someone else to die. You hold that poison in. Let it go. Now, there may be times in your life, especially if you've been abused, if you've suffered some kind of childhood trauma, and people say, we just have to forgive them. That's all. You just have to forgive them. I think where we get stuck, again, in society, we sort of say, forgive and forget, which means that if you forgive, you forget what was done to you. And I don't believe that that's what forgiveness is. I don't believe that we condone behavior when we forgive it. I think what we do is we let go of its hold on us, that it is a self-love to offer forgiveness to either ourselves or someone else. And if we can't do that, then maybe that's demonstrating to us a direction that we need to do some personal work. I'm not saying that you have to forgive to be totally healthy, but if you can't forgive, that's a really good tool to get underneath it and say, why can't I? What's stopping me from forgiving? And it could be simply your definition of forgiveness in my way of thinking. You don't have to forgive and forget, but you have to stop holding on to it so that it causes you anxiety and perhaps triggers you into something that you don't want to do.
Summer evening, drunk to hell, I've sat there nearly lifeless. An old man in the corner sang where the water lilies grow. And on the jukebox, Johnny sang about a thing called love, and it's how we care. What's your name and how'd you bloody know? In blood and death, neath the screaming sky, I lay down on the ground. The arms and legs of other men were scattered all around. Some cursed, some prayed, then cursed, some prayed, then bled some more. And the only thing that I could see was a pair of brown eyes that was looking at me. But when we got back, label parts 1 to 3, there was no pair of brown eyes waiting for me. A rove and a rove and a rove and I'll go for a pair of brown eyes. I looked at him. Hate him. While Ray and Philomena sang my elusive dream, I heard the streams and rolling hills where his brown eyes were waiting, and I thought about a pair of brown eyes that waited once for me. So drunk to hell, I left the place, sometimes crawling, sometimes walking. A hungry sound came across the breeze, so I gave the walls a talking. I heard the sounds of long ago come from the old canal, and the birds in the trees where the wind was gently laughing. And a rove and a rove and a rove and I'll go. A rove and a rove and a rove and I'll go. A rove and a rove and a rove and I'll go for a pair of brown eyes. For a pair of
seven, eight. How many of them have people who are parking and then gonna join them in the line, you know?
Oh my oh god, that my is the god. Worst.
Pisses me off.
So fucking annoying.
So
just get there together.
Fucking annoying. Just get there together. Just park far away, show up.
It just makes you look rude.
You it's know? Not that it just makes you look rude.
You're rude. You are rude. Yes. Oh my god, no one ever thinks like this. And I hate the friends that you have that make you do it. They're the worst.
Yeah. I went to a movie with a friend the other week. She got in the line. I was late. I was late because I got stuck in traffic and I left my house late. But I refused. I refused to get in the line with her. So I actually waited in the back of the line. And she didn't save a seat for me in the movie. So we watched the movie separately.
Wow.
And then she was getting picked up and her boyfriend was pretty impatient. So we actually never saw each other.
That's dedication. Like, I admire the fact that you went to the back of the line.
Cause.
Yes.
You have to be.
Common courtesy.
Courteous. Yeah.
See, look. Right there.
A child joining their dad.
And why? In needed to go to the washroom?
Who's still here in the kitchen working?
It's not really a 9 to 5. I'd say it's more like a sun up to sundown. We opened June 1st of 2010. I really felt the need to exhibit and showcase my culture. There was a lot of people of Caribbean, Latin, an African descent in Vancouver, but didn't have a place that represented them. It's just really nice to see people be proud of who they are, as opposed to having to fit into another box that doesn't really represent them. We have some unique challenges just because we're located on the downtown east side. You know, people just kind of congregating and hanging out outside of the restaurant, sometimes trying to sell paraphernalia, clothes, drugs. That can be hard. It can be hard for the staff sometimes. We saw two guys having an altercation. And unfortunately, we saw the altercation come to a place where, you know, someone was killed. And it happened around the corner from here. I feel like I've seen and felt the energy change when there's new drugs kind of on the streets. We saw an increase in activity, in violence, and in overdoses. I'm not, you know, advocating for, you know, the police or any other agencies to come in here and round people up and throw them in a truck and drive them away. But I do think there's a way that the residents of the downtown east side can be cared for. But I just don't see it happening quick enough. We provide food sometimes and we have extra food in the evenings. You know, we'll hand it out to people on the streets. So it's really more about like being a part of the community as opposed to looking down at anybody. It means a lot to us when people make the decision to come and support us and support what we're doing, you know, because it is bigger than food and drinks.
That's a good one. Hey folks, how you doing? Gary Berry here for Lockport Gambino and Ford. How you doing? Guess what time of the year it is?
Halloween!
That's right, Beth. It's time for our big Halloween sale. Yeah. Which means one of two things down here at Lockport Gambino and Ford. Well, first of all, it's low, low prices. How low are they?
Well, they don't cost an arm and a leg.
That's right. And it also means haunted freaking houses. And we're not talking your little kitty haunted houses. We're talking some real scary Hannibal Lecter, you must be crazy to go in here kind of stuff. And guess what we got in our haunted house this year? Do you know, Bear?
I don't know. It's a surprise.
Stop fooling. You designed half of it, you maniac. Level one in the haunted house is going to be the scariest thing ever. It's called the Hannibal Lecter blood bath. That's right. You are going to have to take a bath in blood for 15 minutes to purify yourself before you can go through the rest of this haunted house.
I can't believe it!
Neither can I. Then after that, what do you take when you take a needle and a slingshot? Oh, that's right. It's called a spiritual needle. We're going to be throwing needles everywhere. Dodge them if you can. It's going to be spooktacular. Then what's up next? It's Moon Man's Fever. What's that sound like? Oh, it's just a Martian disease that makes you feel like you got Ebola for a couple hours? This is the spookiest freaking haunted house ever. After that, it's when things get real adult. Real adult. We're talking about strippers, not just regular strippers, ladies with piranhas instead of areolas. You're never gonna be so terrified of a nipple as this in your life. That's when we really start to ramp it up at the next one. It's called the Maniac's Ball. You go in and it's from 1995 and it's prom. And there's a bunch of maniacs that want to dance with you or eat your face. You don't know, but you'll find out at the end if you come out without a face or maybe even a corsage. Then you get to the end where you pick and see if you get candy or a free deal on a new car, but you know, that's boring stuff. It's all about the spooks.
He's my brother, he's scary. Come on down, you're gonna love it.
Says the guy who wet himself in the haunted house last week.
We promised we weren't going to talk about that.
Well, I'm sorry. My therapist said I need to talk more with you.
My therapist said not to talk to you anymore.
We go to the same guy. This is crazy.
Dr. Fucking Blizzard.
For you, man.
Yeah.
That's a question you could answer. Like, what has changed for you?
Yeah.
Do you mind answering that?